Imagine being in the Olympics and not knowing it. Imagine winning an Olympic championship and not realizing it. Today it would be unthinkable. The Olympics are a worldwide spectacle. But in the beginning, they were a sideshow. Some of the events, like tug of war, wouldn't have been out of place at a county fair. The second Olympics, for 1900, were awarded to Paris. The storied capital of France was also holding a World's Fair, and the Olympics were simply added to the list of fair attractions. Golf was on the Olympic menu for both men and women, the latter slated for a 9-hole competition. Among those in the field were several Americans, including society notable Mary Abbott and her daughter Margaret. They had been introduced to golf by Chicago Golf Club founder Charles Blair McDonald in the mid-1890s, shortly after they had been introduced at a party.
In 1897, her mother joined the Chicago Golf Club. And as a result, Margaret and her brother Sprague came out here to Wheaton to play. And if they were like most of the members, they came out here to stay for parts of the summer. There was a lot of lodging here on site. And Margaret would have quickly gone from beginner to a pretty good player. And the reason for that is that she learned from three very specific and very important individuals, two of whom are already in the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame. Charles Blair McDonald, our founder, the first U.S. amateur champion. Second one was our first golf pro, and as far as I know, the first golf pro in the Midwest and, you know, in the Chicago area, James Fallis. And Jim Fallis was, in addition to being a golf pro, was a really good player, and he won the second U.S. Open at Shinnecock Hills. And then the third individual was somebody that also traveled in the same social circles. His name was H.J. Jim Wiggum. And he was a teacher at Lake Forest College. So she learned from three individuals who between them won four of the first nine national championships. There weren't that many players in America. There weren't that many good players in America. And she learned from three of the best. And so she quickly went from, in May of 1897, being a beginner, to later that summer being a 19 handicap, and the following summer playing off a scratch.
Margaret Abbott became an immediate contender in any tournament she entered, finishing second in the 1897 Governor's Cup at Onwencia, the leading tournament for women in the West. She had been playing for about 5 months. By June of 1898, Margaret won the Deering Cup at Chicago Golf Club, and on the same day won a playoff for the Hamlin Cup, for which she had tied a few days earlier. But by 1899, she was in Paris, along with her mother, an author, who would write a book while her daughter studied French art from the masters themselves. The excitement of the World's Fair attracted the Abbotts, and they attended the opening ceremony for the Olympics in mid-July. Months later, they saw a notice for a golf tournament connected with the fair at Compiègne and entered it.
Margaret Abbott led the competition of 10 players from start to finish. And at one point, the spectators were so interested and crowded around that the competitors had difficulty even getting their shots off. Now, the winners of the Olympic competition were presented with a porcelain bowl trimmed in gold.
But what Margaret did not know was that competition was in fact an Olympic event, and she was the first woman representing the United States of America to win an Olympic competition. As the reward of a bowl indicates, there was no medal ceremony, as the Paris Olympics did not have medals for women's events. Those, along with the Olympic flag, torch, and the many ceremonial trappings, would come later. Margaret Abbott, thinking she had won a mere local tournament, would never know of her Olympic feat. Not after she returned to the U.S., not after she married the newspaper columnist Finley Peter Dunn, the Mike Royko of his time, and thanks to his friendship with McDonald, one of the founders of the National Golf Links of America.
Certainly her victory in the event in Paris, certainly the fact that she's the first female American gold medalist, is an amazing achievement that is worthy of celebration all by itself. I think the fact that the first golf champion, the first Olympic golf champion, was formed here in Wheaton by the first Illinois PGA professional, the fact that her game and her knowledge of golf were formed by two prior members of the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame was significant. And, you know, Margaret really was only with us for a couple of years in her golf life. And, you know, she went to Paris and she really never came back. But the entire rest of her life, she played the golf that she learned here from McDonald, Fallis, and Wiggum.
Although she didn't think about it at the time, she was a pathfinder and she was a pioneer. And I also think that she may have been a role model. Satiety columns were really early harbingers of women's sports. And daily accounts of women in various activities, especially golf in the 1900s, and then as well as tennis, may have inspired other women to take up golf.
She would be a worthy person to join all those other amazing people that are already in the hall. And we were thrilled when we found out that she had been selected. One of the really great parts for me of this process was finding and getting to know Dr. Paula Welch that I talked about before, the Olympic researcher, and Dr. Peter Dunn. Now, Dr. Peter Dunn was Margaret's grandson, and he lived outside of Tampa, and he had actually played with Margaret. My mind immediately went to how best to share this great news and their excitement. So for Dr. Dunn, of course, he had played with Margaret, and he is the only was the only living person. Unfortunately, we lost him in August. He's the only living person who would ever remember playing with her. So it was a great validation of his grandmother.
She would usually win because her short game was so good. She still had some wooden shafted clubs, and she'd play with them. And she had this very slow backswing. Just see her, and you know, very slow backswing, and then plump. And she was deadly accurate. And I would outdrive her by 100 yards, but I'd be over here or over there, and she was boom, boom, boom. And I wasn't smart enough to figure out maybe you should improve your short game, Buster, and get a little more accuracy. But I was very proud of her, and I would tell my friends, well, Marta beat me again. You know, she really was a good golfer.
For Dr. Welch, I think this is a great celebration of the amazing work she did. So I was so excited about that. My second thought went immediately to Bessie Anthony. Of course, Bessie was inducted the last induction ceremony. Bessie won the 1903 Women's Amateur here. And I think of Bessie and Margaret a lot, and I'm desperate to find some golf connection between the two of them. Margaret would have been a little bit older than Bessie, but they would have played golf generally in the same time and generally in the same places. And I don't know whether they played against each other, but I'd like to think they would. So the fact that they're going to be in the Hall of Fame together makes me smile.
Not until decades after her death in 1955 was the family informed by Olympic researcher Paula Welch that she was America's first female Olympic champion. The U.S. Olympic Committee didn't even have her name spelled correctly. That was corrected. The family was delighted. Now, 123 years after the signal success of her brief competitive career, we're pleased to induct Margaret Abbott Dunn into the Illinois Golf Hall of Fame.